Welcome to worship on the fifth Sunday after the Epiphany, also known as Super Bowl Sunday. I want everybody to take a deep breath right now. And Lord, now you're fully inflated, right? It's easy to feel deflated when things don't go well in our lives, especially when we wind up messing up and maybe we miss that goal, we don't get the yardage we want in life. This morning we start by coming before God to confess our failings to Him and receive His forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to stand as you wish as we sing our opening hymn. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. This is a feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you sent your only Son as the word of life for our eyes to see and our ears to hear. Help us to believe with joy what the Scriptures proclaim through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
First reading, Isaiah 58, verses 1 through 9. Shout out, do not hold back. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people their rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Yet day after day they seek me and delight to know my ways, as if they were a nation that practiced righteousness. And did not forsake the ordinance of their God, they ask me of righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Why do we fast, but you do not see? Why humble ourselves, but you do not notice? Look, you serve your own interest on your fast day. Look, you fast only to quarrel and to fight and to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is such the fast that I choose, a day to humble oneself? Is it to bow down the head like a bulrush and to lie in sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, and bring the homeless poor in your home? When you see the naked, to cover them, and not to hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. Glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, Here I am. Psalm 112, verses 1 through 10. Praise the Lord. Happy are those who fear the Lord, who greatly delight in his commandments. Wealth and riches are in their houses, and their righteousness endures forever. It is well with those who deal generously and lend, who conduct their affairs with justice. They are not afraid of evil tidings. Their hearts are firm, secure in the Lord. They have distributed freely, they have given to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. Their horn is exalted in honor.
The wicked see it in our hand, they gnash their teeth in a melting way. The flag of the wicked comes in our hand.
Second reading, 1 Corinthians 2, verses 1 through 12. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom. For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet among the mature we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of the age or of the rulers of this age who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For what human being knows what is truly human except the human spirit that is within? So also no one comprehends what is truly God's except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit that is from God, so that we may understand the gifts bestowed on us by God.
Gospel according to Matthew, the 5th chapter. Jesus said, You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? For it is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a bushel basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Brothers and sisters, grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Is it just me? Or do you sometimes wonder how it is that the crackers that are labeled unsalted tops are still called saltines? Have you ever tried to hide your light under a blanket while reading at night? Last Sunday, we began hearing Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, which starts, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." This morning, Jesus talks about what it means to be blessed and to act as those who are blessed, to act in ways that bless others. I was clicking through the internet this week and ran across an article by one George Harry Bonney entitled "Salt and Light, 83 Years of Wessington Springs College." Now, the college had long gone by the time I got here, but I have no doubt, and I can see evidence today, that that Christian college was indeed salt and light to this community, adding flavor to the community and enlightening it, making it more visible, making it a beacon in many ways to those both within and outside of the borders of this community. Jesus said, if you are a light, then don't hide that light under a basket. And if you are salt, let your flavor be known, lest you be tossed on the ground and trampled underfoot, which is okay if you're throwing salt on ice, but maybe not on your food. Now, it's true that you don't need a lot of salt or a lot of light to do God's work. If you are a baker, you know that just a little bit of salt can make chocolate chip cookies taste sweeter. So with you and I. Just a little bit of salt in the world can make life a little sweeter. And just a little bit of light in the night, in a dark place, can make the world a little safer. We saw this on Wednesday night when we were showing a movie in the fellowship hall, and the cooks still had to get outside and were guided by the light. Now, that same light that can add security can also be dangerous to those who prefer the darkness. And that same salt that adds flavor can also add pain to an injury or a cut. So with us, when we are salt and light, we may injure those that seek to dwell in darkness. We may cause pain to those who seek to drown all the flavor out of life. It takes courage to stand up to those that would rebel against the salt and the light, to try to extinguish the light and drown the salt. It takes courage. For the Jews of Jesus' time, the law and the prophets were to be the light for their way. And for many, it still was. But there were those, the leaders, the Pharisees, and the scribes who had sought to domesticate the light, to tame the salt and contain it, to codify the law in ways that would make it more easy to be enforced, and to take the prophets and diminish their power by limiting them to worship and ritual. But in doing this, in trying to control and domesticate the salt and the light, they had added a burden to their people. A burden of laws, 613, rather than the Ten Commandments that we study in confirmation class. A burden also of oppression, as they neglected the words of the prophets, like those of Isaiah, who said that the proper fast, the proper worship that he would choose would be to loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, to break every yoke, to give bread to the hungry, and bring the poor into their houses, to clothe the naked and be visible among one's own people as the light that breaks forth in the morning and gives health and life to the earth. See, for Jesus, the command to kill, not to kill rather, was not limited to that chalk drawing on the floor, not limited to deadly force, but was opened up to life-giving force. And so Jesus himself was an example of that, as he fed the hungry, clothed the naked, raised the dead back to life. Jesus said, I don't come to abolish the law and the prophets, but to fulfill them, to even be them. In his words and his examples, he showed the meaning behind the commandment, the meaning behind the prophecy, the life and the light that they were meant to bring to the world. No more would people have to walk around worried that they might break a command, that they might somehow tarnish what God had given them, but instead to use what God had given them for the life and the health of others, to take those broken eggs and scramble them up into something healthy and nutritious and life-giving. No more would people seek to run from the light, in this case, flashing lights, but be encouraged to be the light. So that famous passage, Jesus says, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Our youth here and our saviors have had opportunities, many of them, to serve in the banquet, feeding the hungry in Sioux Falls, to collect food for the hungry in this community, and to serve in other ways. Some of you have made quilts and other items to help those in need who needed warmth and comfort, or taken the needy into your homes. These are all ways that we can be salt and light in the world. No more do we need to wait for the light to change but to be the change in the world. So Mother Teresa said, don't expect your friend to be a perfect person, but help your friend to become a perfect person. That's true friendship, to be the light, to be the salt, to help one another reach the high expectations that God has for each of us. I don't know if any of you have been to Carlsbad Caverns in New Mexico. When I was down there, I was privileged to be in there. And at a certain point, you go down to the very darkest and deepest and lowest portion in those caverns. And then they turn out the lights. And in one of those excursions, there was a family with a little girl. And when the lights went out, the girl began to cry. And her brother turned to her and said, don't worry. Somebody knows how to turn on the light. We live in a world where darkness looms and destruction is all too evident. God calls us in the midst of that to turn on the light, to be the light for others. These next 3 weeks in our community youth group, we're going to be hearing this passage from 1 Timothy. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, in purity. We all know individuals, adults and humans, to whom others look up. I've known some children who might not otherwise have been qualified to be in the Head Start program because of income, but were placed in there to be examples to others, to be the light to others. And what I'm going to be doing these next 3 weeks is to invite each of those 25, 35 youth to be a positive example for those around them. That youth group comprises about one-third of the junior and senior high student body. That would be a mighty bright light if they could rise to that challenge. Jesus announced, I am the light of the world. And now he gives that gift and that invitation to each of us this morning to be the flavor, to be the light, to be that which lifts up and enlightens the world. Amen. Please rise for the hymn. We confess our faith in the words of the ancient creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. Third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We include in our prayers this morning Ed Bushnell, who is Julie Fosdock's father. He is not well, and she went to be with him this week. Filled with the power of the Holy Spirit through baptism, let us come before the throne of God to offer prayers for the needs of the church and the world. For your church, that we may be salt and light in a world of darkness, adding flavor and showing the way that you intend your people to live, God of light. For leaders and nations, that they make work to lighten the burdens of others and lead in ways that make for peace and freedom, God of light. For those living under oppressive governments and conditions, that you would set them free, God of light. For those who received prayer shawls such as we have here this morning, and all those who are ill or in need of pain, ill and or in pain, especially Ed and Luella, Tom and Dwayne, Vi and Kim, Jason and Walt, Geraldine and Deb, Audrey and Don, John and Erica and Ken and Christy and Sonny, and Conrad, and Jackie, and Stephen, and Jake, that you might bring them healing, God of light. We praise you for your light that shines on us this day. Give us the courage to take up that light and lead others to you in preparation for the day when your light will dawn upon all people forever, God of light. God of faithfulness, through the revelation of your Son, we stand before you without fear and lift up to you all in need. In Jesus' name, hear and answer our prayers according to your steadfast love. Amen. Peace to the Lord Jesus Christ be with you always. Please turn and greet one another with that peace. God has blessed us with his gifts and his light and our life. We respond to him with our tithes and our offerings. Thank you. Merciful Father, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and proper that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord. Sharing our life, he lived among us to reveal your glory and love, that our darkness should give way to his own brilliant light. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The things of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated as the ushers wait on you.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of those whom you have fed with one heavenly food, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.